of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
At one point in my early adulthood, my mother took all of the furniture that had been in storage, that had been in our house when I was a teenager. She took it all out of storage. And there was the chest that had been in my bedroom. And as I opened the top drawer, I found three things saved from those years. First, there was a cartoon. Second, there was a pamphlet, a religious pamphlet written by an actress who was an active member of Hollywood Presbyterian Church. And thirdly, there was an envelope from the Billy Graham organization containing a copy of the Four Spiritual Laws and other materials. And that was it. I had gone to the Billy Graham Crusade in Los Angeles in the early 1960s when I was probably around 14 years old with my youth leader at Encino Presbyterian Church. His brother was Billy Graham's business manager, which was a job that he held for over 40 years. I know at the point of decision in that crusade, I had raised my hand that I wanted to receive Jesus as my Savior, and had gone forward and been prayed for, and that this material that I found in my drawer was a follow-up from that organization. Looking back, I view my response at the crusade as a conscious assent and confirmation of something I had naturally believed since a childhood awareness of God, that this was real and true and something that was meaningful for me. Perhaps this was my first conscious encounter with Christ, one that made more clear an understanding of God's love expressed in Christ. Preaching from today's text is not easy. Not as easy as one might think. This passage from John contains perhaps what is the most well-known words in Scripture for Christians. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. And earlier in this chapter, as we go back and read a bit, the stage is set for Nicodemus. This is the setting of this. Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night in the darkness and asks him, you know, what must I do to be saved? And he says, you must be born from above. Other translations say, you must be born again, new. Jesus says you must be born, you're born of the flesh, you must also be born of the Spirit. So this all fits together. We are born of the flesh, but we must also be born of the Spirit. And to be born of the Spirit is to believe in Jesus as the Son of God. Then will we be born anew, or again, from above, and receive eternal life. Now, some people have some pretty specific ways when they talk about how this all happens. It happens in a certain way, through a certain encounter, using certain words, making a specific statement regarding being born again. However, as I read these words from John, it seems that regardless of my presentation or experience, if I believe, I am received by God and am given eternal life. And this might take place at the altar during Eucharist, or while I'm singing a beloved hymn, or on a hike in the mountains, or it is something that is so ingrained in my entire experience as a person that the encounter is already part of my DNA. Actually, one friend told me once that she received Christ in a swimming pool, which I think is an extraordinary evangelical outreach. regardless of how, when, or under what circumstances we come to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, what John is telling us here is that believing in Jesus brings God's gift of eternal life. So what is eternal life to us? Is it merely a get-out-of-hell free card? Is this the end of our experience and journey? Are we so safe through salvation and comfortable in that salvation? Is this a kind of spiritual retirement? What does eternal life have to do with life here and now? Dietrich Bonhoeffer, German theologian and pastor during the years of Nazi Germany, talked about so beautifully present in our reading from Ephesians this morning. He talked about the gift of grace, God's grace, by which we are received by God. And he talked about the danger of cheap grace. Bonhoeffer wrote, "Cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance, baptism without church discipline, communion without confession, absolution without personal confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Jesus Christ, living and incarnate." In contrast, Bonhoeffer offers costly grace. He says that costly grace is the treasure hidden in the field. For the sake of it, a man will go and sell all that he has. It is the pearl of great price by which the merchant will sell everything to achieve. It is the kingly rule of Christ, for whose sake a man will pluck out his eye if it causes him to stumble. It is the call of Jesus Christ at which the disciples leave their nets and follow him. And it is costly grace that gives us eternal life. The concept of eternal life in John is not necessarily about duration. Eternal life has dual components. It is something that we will have forever, living in the presence of God in this life and in the life beyond this. But it is also an overlap in this life. In this life, eternal life is about a qualitatively different experience of this life, something transformed by God. It is an experience of possibility that reflects the radical nature of Jesus' teachings and God's urgency to transform his world into the kingdom of love. So eternal life is the grace-filled gift of God that moves our point of immediate spiritual experience from the afterlife into the present, where we encounter Jesus as Savior, model, and mentor, and are invited to live a qualitatively different life through our faith in him and his love. We are the people that no longer seek to live in the darkness of our own sins, our narcissistic needs, or our own self-interest. In the lesson today from Ephesians, Paul writes, "We are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has prepared beforehand to be our way of life." This is eternal life experienced now, transforming us and helping us grow in ways that brings Jesus' radical love to the world. As such, we are those who would live in the light, rejecting the darkness of inertia and uncaring, willing to live the costly grace, leaving our nets and following Jesus. We come to the light because Christ has made us these people, those who seek healing for our world, rejecting injustice, oppression, and the violation of human dignity. Anything that would break what God has meant for us to be. Eternal life is anything but quiet, safe, or calm. This life is filled with the dangerous love of Christ, illuminating our lives and the life of the world. So as we continue during these last weeks of our Lent journey, may we reflect on the costly grace that has received us into God's love, the costly grace of the cross. It is this grace that enfolds our community here at Epiphany, that animates our love and our support of one another, and that invites us to be in the world what Paul has called ambassadors of Christ. May God help us to discern the persons and places to which God is calling us, where we can be a light in the darkness, and by doing so, where we can glorify Christ, our Savior.